on remote reading of radiology images. We're excited to share a wealth of information today regarding best practices regarding this popular topic. Thank you for investing the time with us today. We have a few hundred people that have joined the call today, so really want to thank you for your time and this opportunity to share this information and insights with you. Looking at the attendee list and registration list, we've got out of these few hundred folks that are on, we have CIOs, we have chiefs of radiology, we have a number of radiologists, we have a number of enterprise PACS system administrators, we have PACS administrators, we have IT experts, and we have a number of our partners and sellers that help us market and promote these solutions throughout the marketplace. So thank you for joining very much. All right, so again, as an incentive for joining the call today, it's our pleasure to give a $15 Uber Eats card. So one of the things out of a few hundred people, and again, since we cover the East Coast, there's certain states that aren't allowed to accept the $15 incentive, or there may be some hospitals that then allow you to accept the gift. So if you'd like us to donate it to somebody, or if you are not able to accept it, if you could please in the chat, just post in the chat your name and a quick not able to accept the card, and we'll be glad to exclude you from that list, so there's no challenges with that. And for those of you that were on the mammography webinar, we did send out the gift cards, and we've gotten a few emails back. We use a third party since there's so many people that we send it out to. So if you are on that last call, and also as a heads up for this call, you'll be getting an email with the $15 Uber Eats gift card from a third party company called Prezzee, P-R-E-Z-Z-E-E. So if you were on the last call and are looking to maybe combine your two $15 cards and upgrade your meal or invite a friend, just be on the lookout for that. So. To get started, I'd like to introduce the team. So my name is Jeff Wilson. I'm the first mug there on the left, and I'm the sales director for the East Coast of the United States for Barco. On the team is Jeff Deacon. So Jeff is our BDR in the New England area. Jeff's going to be the primary speaker along with Eric Robinson on the call today, and they've done a great job putting together a wealth of content. Eric Robinson, as well as Steve Muller, whose picture's not on there, are our PSEs. They're pre-sales, post-sales engineers that are strategic resources available to our users, help with drivers, setups, et cetera, and setting up demonstration systems and just being a wealth of knowledge for our customers and potential customers. Steve Okla is the next one. Steve is our BDR in the state of Florida. And then Jennifer Helmrich is our BDR in for New Jersey, Maryland, Delaware, and DC. And then Glenn Davis is our BDR for the Carolinas, the Virginias, and the state of Georgia. So if you didn't capture that, we will have a recording that'll be sent out on this, but you also can just post in the chat, hey, I'd like somebody to give me a call. And our goal is to be available, and if we can promote some post-engagement conversations, know that we will consider that a win if we can engage with you additionally after this call today. So let's see, so that is the team. And then from an objectives perspective, you know, if we do a quick look at the agenda, our goal today is to share a few of the common use cases that we see out there for remote reading. And then we also want to share information on the different types of displays and how they may best fit your needs. And then also many folks, as they first look at, hey, how am I going to move this radiology reading environment externally from the hospital? Oftentimes there's a thought of, hey, there's no budget. How can we do this very cheaply? We're going to share with you some economic ideas. But then we're also going to share some of the technology considerations if somebody's looking at a non-diagnostic display, some of the things that you don't learn that you need as part of the workflow and part of the tools that actually create a lower ROI and create a lower risk profile for remote reading. So That is our goal today, and that is the objective that we're excited to share with you today, and we have content to back that up. And if you look at remote reading, you know, the concept is something that's been building over the last few years. There's some very large groups that have deployed barcode technology to 600 patients that are primary remote readers. There's hospitals that have deployed very large scale barcode solutions to their homes. There's the VA deployed over 400 of the barcode solution sets in a unique configuration utilizing our EGFX cards. And it's our goal here to share some of those ideas. And with the advent and challenges that have been provided with the COVID-19 pandemic, it's really brought this discussion to the forefront. So let's jump into some of the business and technology drivers that have really pushed and enabled this remote reading. And but first, we've got a simple poll question. So if we could go to right here, we're there. So if I could focus your eyes to the poll question, we've got, you know, if you would just please answer, and we'll share the responses of what is your current remote reading strategy. So yeah, we'll give you about 30 seconds to focus on A, B, C, and D. And if you could just pick the real quickly, the one that best applies to your current situation, that would be great. And we'll share a quick overview of the responses. Okay, it's coming up. Quick trigger. Okay, we've got about 15 seconds more. So speed bonus. If you don't know, D is a good answer. There's no penalty for a wrong answer. Okay, looks like time's up. I'm gonna have some data to share here. All right, so 41% of you on the call have answered that you already have a home reading solution implemented. Just 3% is that we don't have a home reading solution. So quite a large bit of adoption with the folks that are on the call. And then this is really an opportunity that we hope you learn some additional nuggets. 21% of you currently have a solution, but think it may lack features or capabilities for reading all exams and need some updating. So we're getting a lot of questions around reading chest as well as mammography at home. And those are all things that we'll touch on here today. So 20% are here to learn. So those are, we really appreciate it. And that gives us a little bit of a mix of who's on here. So thank you. And with that, I'll turn it over to my colleague, Jeff Deacon. Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you, Jeff. And thank you all for joining us today. We appreciate your time. My name is Jeff Deacon, and I am the Business Development Manager for New York and New England. Prior to 2020, working from home was a luxury that was being explored by a few hospitals for a couple of their employees. And then COVID-19 came, the world shut down, and tales of IT staff loading up radiologists' cars with computer equipment and strapping a barcode display in a seatbelt became part of the normal conversation. Home reading demanded attention. Luckily, since patient interaction is limited to begin with, radiology, as a specialty, was among the early ones to start working remotely without much impact on clinical performance. Today, as hospitals are now starting to go back to somewhat normal scheduling, it's still challenging and not all that appealing to have 3, 4, 5 rads sitting in a tiny windowless reading room all day. And many of the radiology leaders I have spoken with expect a blend of remote and in-office reading to stay well after the COVID pandemic is over. They are also considering this blended option as a way to offset the overflow of an expected post-COVID surge. With the exception of interventional radiology, most RADs can provide clinical support and work efficiently remotely as long as they have a decent setup at home. But it's not just about COVID though. There are other unexpected events that can have an impact on productivity. For example, here in the Northeast, in the East Coast, there are hurricanes and blizzards. We have flu season and school closures where staying home may be the only option for some doctors. But we can work through these unpredicted events if we plan for it. But besides the natural event occurrence that can affect productivity, there is another reason to consider supporting home reads. This new generation entering the workforce is already used to exploring alternate ways of working, especially when productivity is equal to, or in some cases better than, being in the hospital, as interruptions can be avoided when reading from home compared to working in the hospital space. Additionally, with the shortage of radiologists, especially in remote areas, it has become common to offer full PACS workstations to read from home as an incentive for new hires by many practices and healthcare facilities. Well, we've covered some of the why we want to read from home. Now let's talk a little bit about the who. It is important to really understand the workflow one is trying to address for home reading, and all home reading situations are not the same. While every organization has its own unique need or reason to explore a home reading strategy, you can usually put them in three scenarios. Those three are the occasional yet consistent need to review images. This is the case where a radiologist has to read one or two cases, maybe over the weekend or when on call to provide expertise in special cases for your ER team. Only a few cases are to be reviewed and consulted, while the final read and dictation is done when back in the main location. We have flexible scheduling where radiologists are mostly in the hospital, but also prefer to have the flexibility to work from home at times to avoid commute challenges or just to have some work-life balance. This scenario also serves as a fallback should any unexpected volume surge occur by having team members at home with full diagnostic reading access if this situation arises. The last scenario is a full-time production user that is reading remotely, which is also a relatively common theme with the consolidation of large radiology groups and the growth of more and more 24/7 home reading services. This configuration mimics the hospital setup and is also the bucket where we would put mammo reading in. To sum it up, the more you are reading at home, the more robust your system should be. Now, putting those scenarios in terms of monitors, there are the typical displays you could use for each scenario with the understanding that this is not a set rule and each facility has their own unique considerations. The occasional user could use a clinical review display. It's great for wet reads and cardio. A flexible user will typically read off of a pair of 2 megapixels or a 4 megapixel, since they have fewer cases to read where speed is not a major factor and panning and zoom is not an issue, but having a QA sensor built in that can automatically calibrate and measure the display is important. And with a production user, which as mentioned, will want a similar setup to the hospital where speed of read is a factor, we'll typically use a pair of 3 megapixel displays or a single 6, which both have the built-in sensor for constant QA QC. Not listed on this list is the mammo monitors we have, as we have reviewed those options during our last lunch and learn. If you missed that session, let us know and we'll send you a recording after this. So let's jump into another poll while staying on the different scenarios. I'm curious how you're leveraging your home reading today. Are you using it as an occasional on-call? Is it option B, which is a flexible schedule or used for like overflow? C, which is full-time production? Or D, you're here still trying to figure out what works best? We'll give you about 45 seconds to answer that. And fun fact from NOAA and the National Weather Service, in the 30 years from 1980 to 2010, there were 19 severe storms and 12 winter storms in the Northeast that were billion-dollar disaster events. And since 2010, so the past 11 years, there have been 34 storms and 7 winter storms so far that have been multi-billion-dollar disaster events for the Northeast. All right, about 10 more seconds. Appreciate you participating in these polls. All right, time's up, and let's see what we have here. Okay, looks like it's an even split here. You have 9% that are showing as occasional, 26 that use that flexible schedule, 34% reads full-time and they have a full production use on it, and then we have 26 that are still trying to find out what works best. All those answers are great. For those that are still trying to find what works best, hopefully we can offer some tips here during the call that'll help guide you on your way. Okay. So thanks again for those answers. And we've covered the why and the who. So now let's talk about the how. The biggest challenge for years with implementing home read was the limitation of technology capability and the ability to support that technology remotely. In the last few years, however, advancement in technology has delivered us both smaller PCs and small form factor workstations, as well as docking stations where you can connect multiple monitors to a single laptop. These are all great solutions for home users where desk space is likely limited, and at the same time, the laptops make it much easier to support since the end user can easily bring them into the hospital for the IT staff to update and or troubleshoot as needed. Whether it be through using a small form factor PC or a laptop, the need for techs to make house calls for PC issues could easily become a thing of the past. Staying with the laptops, given the benefit of mobility, we see that most of the PC manufacturers today offer workstation grade laptops that will meet minimum requirement hardware requirements for typical packs. There is a common challenge, however, in deploying laptops that connect to a docking station, and that's maintaining the continuity of the display sequence. Display sequence dictates the way images are laid out by a pack system, hanging protocols, and that layout is affected when a laptop lid is closed or open, or when connecting and disconnecting the laptop from the docking station. That constant disconnect, reconnect also affects the quality assurance and calibration schedule of the displays, since communication between the display and the compliance software is interrupted. Another challenge we found is that the graphics board on the laptop can have some limitation on driving the number of displays at the higher resolution medical will sometimes demand. But technology again caught up, and we could address those challenges through a Thunderbolt or USB-C interface cable. Well, okay, technically a USB-C cable and an external graphics device, commonly referred to as an EGFX box. By connecting a laptop via USB-C to an EGFX box that has a Barco video card installed, as shown in image 1 and 2 here, we can drive up to 4 displays off of the card while providing access to the clinical workflow tools that we learned about during our last Lunch and Learn session, as well as maintaining a continuous connection to the QA Web asset management and calibration platform. That is because the EGFX box, which is essentially a docking station with USB ports for keyboard, mouse, dictation mic, or touchpad, as well as a power and network port, is always connected to the displays and to the network. This configuration highlights the simplicity of installation for the end user. And after initial setup, home users only have one cable to plug in, and the EGFX and Barco card combo handles everything else. I'm also seeing this for those RADs that have 2 homes or split their time between the office and home equally, where they will mirror this configuration at both sites, and they'll just use the laptop as a PC, bringing it back and forth. The laptop display also doubles as a nice workless monitor too. So with this setup, you have the imaging power of a tower with the mobility of a laptop. This brings us to our third poll. Now I'm curious on how you're using your technology today. So do you support the home reading solution with A, a professional grade workstation, similar to one used in your hospital reading rooms? B, those small form factor PCs or small form tinies? C, the laptop? D, you don't know, the radiologists are on their own buying their own PCs? Or E, you need advice and you would like to talk? We have about 40 seconds. Appreciate your answering. All right, we'll give it 20 more seconds. All right, time is up. Let's see where we're at. Wondering if the team were taking guesses on the answers here. Look at that. All right. So 66% use a professional grade workstation. 9% use the small form factor or tinies. 11% with laptops. And then a handful here and there don't know or they need advice. That's great. That's typically what we see is they just mimic what they have in a hospital. Or like I said, in some cases, they took the PCs out of the hospital and brought it right to the RAD's home when the pandemic, of course, first started. Okay. So we've spoken about the technology, and now home reading is not just about compute power and display layout. There are a couple of other things to consider when building out a home reading room. I've just read this article last week, I think it was in Becker's or something like that, where UPenn Department of Radiology did a study, and they found that neck discomfort, back, hip, and shoulder pain were all reported by their home users. Nearly all providers from the study were told to elevate their feet during the day for more support, and they found that a handful of the users had their monitors too low, causing neck pain. Incorrect chair and desk heights also contributed to pain points. So this just highlights that it's not just about choosing the correct monitor or PC. So it's not just about the technology when building out a home reading room. There are many factors to think through. So I put together this checklist to highlight some of the other considerations, like having an external puck if you don't have a display with built-in sensors, the dictation software, internet speed and connection, the ability to control ambient lighting, including windows, and a clear support model, to name a few. I won't read this line by line in the interest of time, but if you are planning on building out or refreshing a remote or home office, please reach out to your local rep. We're happy to help. We're happy to work with you. We do this all the time, and we may have some insight and think about things that maybe it's not top of mind for you. So please reach out. It's why we're here. Now, each of the use cases and technology drivers that we've discussed can be used in any combination, but the common driving force that affects the correct display selection can be derived from four standards and a reference guide. Looking at these standards and guiding factors, the first general document that outlines things to consider is the ACR white paper on teleradiology practice. The white paper refers to two specific documents to guide us on appropriate display selection for each type of use case. These documents are the technical standard for electronic practice of medical imaging and the IT reference guide for practicing radiologists. Additionally, if you are reading for New York State, regardless of whether you are located in New York, then it becomes necessary to follow the New York State Department of Health requirements for primary diagnostic monitors, also known as PDMs. We at Barco, we follow and comply with all of these documents through all of our compliance software that Eric will discuss later on today. All of these standards, guidelines, and state requirements point to a few key display parameters. They are luminance, DICOM calibration, quality assurance, pixel pitch and resolution. And finally, although not as common, is mammography. And if you are reading from a mammo from home, the MQSA requirements should also be considered. We'll look further into a few of these in a minute. But let's talk about, again, why these guiding factors are in place. Apart from achieving accuracy, reading efficiency, and best patient care, these standards and guidelines are important for organizations in reducing legal exposure as well. The article from Aunt Minnie is written by a professional witness for medical cases, and they listed that one of the 9 ways to reduce legal exposure to PACS problems was to keep calibration records. It helps demonstrate that the standard of care was followed, as well as a commitment to quality of care. So, if you are currently letting your radiologists purchase and maintain their own displays, with little oversight from the hospital they are reading for, there is still a liability, whether it be legal or just public relations, to consider. So, all right, here's a quick pop quiz, folks. We highlighted the factors to consider when choosing a display. So now I'm curious if everybody knows, what is the recommended luminance for general radiology as per the ACR? Is it A, 170 candela per square meter, B, 350, C, 420, or D, 250? We'll have about 40 seconds on the clock there. Fun fact, the ACR, or American College of Radiology, was founded in 1923, just over 25 years after the X-ray was discovered. Okay, we're coming up on about 10 seconds. Again, appreciate the participation. Right, and time is up. Let's see the answers. Excuse me. Looks like we're still calculating. There we go. All right, hey, half of you got it correct at 350 candela. That is fantastic. We do have 420 and 250 as well, some answers there. That's okay. It is relevant, you'll see, and I'll get into that. So it was a little bit of a trick question, but this is fantastic. Thanks for that feedback. Love seeing it. All right, so let's talk a little. We're gonna look a little closer at 3 of the 5 key parameters today. We're starting with luminance. So as mentioned, per the ACR standard, the lowest calibrated brightness should be 350 candela for general radiography, 420 for mammo, and for secondary review, especially in image-enabled EMR applications, a consistent calibrated brightness of 250 candela is also recommended. So as mentioned, let's dig into the first 3 that are listed here today. Luminance or brightness. Studies show that brightness of a monitor has a direct correlation to the accuracy and speed of detection. I read a study that was done in Italy comparing 4 displays set at 4 different luminance levels, and the results were all in favor of setting displays at a higher calibrated luminance. While that report speaks primarily to mammo, the logic applies across the board. Looking at this picture as an example of why brighter is better, you can see greater detail in image number 2. Again, this is an example from mammo, of course, but it applies to plain film as well. But it's not just about how bright, though. It has to be a stable and uniform level of high brightness. Overall, medical grade displays generally provide better luminance uniformity compared with average consumer grade displays, whose luminance uniformity can actually vary by 30% at any given moment. The stability to a medical grade display backlight is due to incorporated technology that compensates for pixel luminance variation in the way that commercial displays simply do not. Barco, for example, has multiple sensors measuring things like pixel uniformity, the DICOM grayscale tone and luminance output of a monitor, and even the ambient lighting surrounding the display. Another reason why backlight stabilizers and testing is important is that the amount of light generated by a CCFL or LED backlight display will decrease over time, resulting in gradual dimming. A monitor luminance, also known as candela, will eventually burn out, just like a candle. Moving on to why do we calibrate? All medical displays should be calibrated to the grayscale standard display function as defined in Part 14 of the DICOM standard, commonly referred to as DICOM Part 14. What does that mean? Well, the definition states that DICOM calibration ensures that all visible shades of gray acquired by the modality and processed through PACS are displayed accurately to make sure the clinical content necessary to reach diagnosis is accurately available for the human eye. Exciting stuff. And while I don't have the time today to do a technical deep dive, DICOM curve and lookup table, here's a fun example. Looking at the image, we can see the gray bar appears lighter on the left and then gradually becomes a darker shade of gray as you move to the right. Now, if I was to take this bar and place it on a white background, do you think it'll look the same? Let's see. Now, that same bar looks like a single gray tone left to right. The previous slide is an optical illusion, and I promise you, I did just cut and paste that same bar from the previous slide onto a white background. This is the best way I can demonstrate why calibrating and, to some extent, controlling ambient lighting is so very important. We need to rely on the XY coordinates of a display because, in this case, seeing is not always believing. So now we've set the correct luminance and we've calibrated within spec, but unfortunately, due to the nature of backlight and display panels, this is not just a set it and forget it process. We need to maintain calibration throughout the lifetime of the display, which makes it necessary to have a sound quality assurance plan that keeps the calibrated brightness consistent over time, as well as ensures all the visible shades of gray within the calibrated brightness range stay intact over the lifetime of the product. Simply put, without a good QA/QC plan in place, it doesn't matter how great your display or home setup is. And with that, I will pass this over to Eric Robinson, who has been with Barco for 20 years and is the product support engineer for the Southeast. Eric?
Thank you, Jeff. As Jeff mentioned, I am the support engineer for the Southeast. I work closely with Glenn Davis and Steve Okla. Barco introduced QOWeb Enterprise in Q4 of 2019 and formally introduced it to the North American market in July 2020. The release was a culmination of years of deployment work aimed at making improvements to the legacy online quality assurance solution by modernizing the security architecture and improving connectivity as well as other improvements. QOWeb Enterprise provides a friendly user interface that is intuitive to ease of use. Let's take a look at some of the hospital trends and challenges facing the hospitals today. Next slide, please. As the population ages, the cost of healthcare skyrockets. Organizations are under pressure to do less, more with less. These trends are increasing the demands for cloud-based automated solutions to provide broad-reaching solutions. Consolidation of healthcare enterprises brings new challenges to manage a growing number of medical assets in multiple locations. Regulatory and compliance standards are getting stricter in every region, and it's difficult for healthcare enterprises to keep up with the changing requirements. Budgets are shrinking, and there are demands to reduce healthcare costs while assuring excellent patient care. Concerns about security, and patient privacy is important, needs to find more efficient ways of doing things, requirements for oversight, management and reporting of QA process for quality standards and audit preparation. 2020 accelerated the home reading market due to the COVID, and we expect it to continue to grow at a significant rate. So we have another poll question. The quality compliance on a remote home reading display. Is it A, completed by the radiologist, or the user, or their own QC reporting? Is it with a standalone software installed on the workstation and is manually measured with an external pup? C, with the standalone software installed on the workstation, but using the built-in sensor on the display. D, using the enterprise software with the automatic measuring and manage remotely. Or E, it's not performed at all. So if you can provide an answer, we have a few more seconds left here. Also a nice fun fact, the first 3D mammal exam was performed in the US in 2011. The first barcode display to receive an FDA clearance for tomo images was in 2011. So you can guess where those images were read off. Okay, so it looks like we have completed the poll. So 6% said that the images were completed by the radiologist. 6% also said with the standalone, it's done with the standalone software installed on the workstation. And 21% said with the software installed on a workstation using the built-in sensor on the display. 47% says using enterprise software with an automatic measuring abilities. And then 4% said not installed. Very good answers. That 47% looks very good. Thank you for participating. Very good. Good answers. Okay. Next slide, please. Now let's talk a little bit about the software solution that Barco has, which will allow one to manage all of this. The Barco Quality Assurance Solution, QA Web Enterprise, is an online cloud solution that allows you to manage your quality assurance of your install base, regardless of the size and location. Here are the top 5 reasons which make QA Web Enterprise the best online quality assurance solution. 0 footprint, no hardware to purchase to host the Barco solution. This is a huge improvement over the QA Web server. There is no gateway connection required for the workstation to maintain connectivity to the server. Next, network independence. Workstations can be on a separate VLAN and there are no connectivity issues. The prior solution required a direct VPN connection. Home radiology reads, the elimination of the VPN requirements falls in line with the needs of today's home reading environment. Fully customizable policies. You can set up your QA Web policies as you want, or you can use the Barco defaults. My preference is to use the Barco default policy for simplicity. The power to control the policies are still available at your disposal. This feature is excellent for large installations and applicable to small facilities as well. Security. Everybody knows security. I think we can't talk enough about this. In today's environment, it's crucial to secure your systems from online threats. I think everyone on this call will agree. Barco QA Web Enterprise uses the latest technology and security standards, which are required to meet today's security needs. Next slide, please. Application security. Here are a few application security features, which includes 248-bit end-to-end encryption. This rivals standard bank levels of encryption. And we also audit logs for traceability. So security is number one with Barco. QR Web Enterprise uses a direct connection to the cloud, and it uses security services embedded in the AWS cloud. This is the Amazon Web Services, which is a state-of-the-art IoT technology for improved performance. The gateway or the relay connection has been eliminated. Next slide, please. QR Web Enterprise introduces a modern cloud-based platform which helps you manage the technical complexities of your enterprise. It is applicable to large enterprise installations down to the small installations. With cloud connectivity, this means your fleet is always up to date with the latest guidelines and regional standards. QR Web Enterprise is easy to configure and manage effortlessly connectivity. No QR Web relay or hardware is required. QR Web Enterprise offers custom policies which can be easily managed across your enterprise. It also allows you the ability to schedule tasks to fit your timetable and quality plan. QR Web Enterprise has a smart notification so that only the personnel responsible for the notification receives that message. For example, if a display fails a diagnostics test, QA Web will automatically start the auto healing feature to try to correct that problem. But if it can't, an email will go out to the persons that are responsible to receive the email. For QA Web management, Barco's displays, for QA management, Barco's displays in hospital imaging centers and home reads, QA Web Enterprise policy manage allows you to easily keep up with your Barco displays and compliance across multiple facilities and multiple regions. This is achieved by simply dragging and dropping the ACR compliant policies to the required location. Next slide, please. Let's look at creating a custom policy, say for New York, which has more stringent QA regulations than the rest of the US. How to solve with QA Web Enterprise. First, you group the New York State hospitals in one organization and create a QA policy geared to the New York State regulation. Then you simply drag and drop the policy to the required location, and now the policies are applied. Easy. The responsibility of the responsible QA persons are typically not near the displays each day the displays are in use to, and they also cannot be there to monitor their reading environment. Well, thanks to the QA Web Ambient Light policy, QA Web Enterprise ensures the displays are read in an optimum reading environment by monitoring the ambient light in the room and can send a notification to the persons that are responsible saying that the displays are not in a suitable reading environment. This can be perfect for home reads when you can't physically be there, when the person can't physically be there. The intuitive dashboard provides a status overview of your install base. The dashboard can easily be configured and for your visibility at high levels, which is like your entire fleet, or you can configure it for individual sites. Excuse me. QA Web Enterprise uses simple to use modern interface. It has a QA reports that the users on the server have relied upon for managing their quality assurance programs. All reports can be exported to Excel. QI Web Enterprise takes the guesswork out of setting the quality assurance frequency for general diagnostics displays. Note, some states' frequency may vary. Once the displays are registered to the QI Web server, the policies are automatically applied. The quality assurance tests are automatic, and most of the intervention-free tasks can run, and this is due to the onboard iGuard sensor in the display. QI Web Enterprise is excellent for mammography and tomo displays. Designed for MQSA compliance, the customizable policies ensures that the quality assurance tests are performed at the correct frequency. Thanks to the iGuard in displays, the automatic and intervention-free QA provides years of MQSA compliance. Displays without built-in iGuard sensors like the iGuard will require measuring with an external photometer. Next slide, please. If you would like to sign up for QI Web Enterprise, you can go to this website. Once you have registered, a member from the team will get in contact with you to help you set up your site and to show you some best practices on the platform. Please look for a follow-up letter from Sheila, and I will turn this over to Jeff Wilson.
Great. Thanks, Eric. That was excellent. Really appreciate the information. If we can get to the next slide. Great. So this is poll question number 6. If you would please select either A, B, C, or D. Quite self-explanatory. And again, we are here for you. We have a full team of technical product experts, people that want to come out and help ship equipment to your facility if you're looking to evaluate the differences between the different solutions that we've talked about. If you're looking to have a call to talk through some of the differences between the displays and how they match up with the use cases, sometimes there's some exceptions that can be rolled out with some different types of solution integrations that take place. So the Barcode team does not sell directly. We're here to make sure that you understand your options so that when you work with our partners, that you feel safe that the investment in Barco is the right investment for you for the long term, not only clinically, technically, but operationally. And we believe that the web-based solution that Eric just talked about is the best in the world. It is web-based, highly secure, very easy to deploy, and provides our users with a great number of tools and management tools to look at your fleet, as well as to make sure that your compliance is there. And if you're ever asked how your compliance is managed, you have tools where you easily can export JCO reports, et cetera, reports for proving out to the governing bodies that you are within compliance for it. So thank you to the team, and thank you for you for attending. A lot of hard work goes into this, and we appreciate it. So 82% appreciated the call, and we appreciate you. And again, one of our goals with the team was to say, hey, what does Barco want out of this? We want to make sure that you guys know that we're here for you. So we see 8% of the folks are interested in some additional information. So if you could post that in the chat or reach out to me or anyone else on the team, we'll make sure that you get the appropriate documentation. We're happy to set up calls and go deeper into the solution sets that are available to you. And I see a couple that want to schedule one-on-ones. And we also have additional videos on really an advanced level going into our software tools. But we feel like we get more from a one-on-one conversations where you can answer some questions. And that's our job. We're here for you. So I would like to say that, you know, we appreciate your time, your attendance. Be on the lookout for the email. It'll probably be Tuesday or Wednesday of next week. You'll get an email from Prezzee, P-R-E-Z-Z-E-E, that will have the $15 Uber Eats card. And I see a couple folks are interested in the mammography video that we, the session that we did a couple weeks ago. And we're happy to send that out. And I just want to say thank you for the team for all the hard work and preparation. And then thank you for all the attendees. Many of you are our existing customers. We want to thank you for working with us. Thank you for attending. The partners that are on, thank you for your efforts. And just know that we're here to support you, and we sincerely love to engage and talk further and make sure that you're making the right decisions and have the right information to make one. So I'll go ahead and I think we have some questions, right? So maybe do we have anything in the chat that we can address here? Look for some help. All right, so there's a chat. Okay, it looks like we've got one that is the mammo acceptance required to be performed by the physicist a one-time event, or does it have to occur every time the monitors are moved to another location? So I'm not the best one to answer that, but if somebody else on the team wants to take that one, or if we want to send some follow-up, we can. I think, go ahead, Eric. Yes.
So the mammo acceptance test, yes, it's part of this. It consists of two tests. One of the tests is done yearly by the physicist. If you move, depends on your facility and with the physicist, if you move, say, displays or workstation to another location, it may have to get re-qualified by the physician, physicist. So please work with your local physicist to verify if any equipment is moved, that entire chain, any part of that chain is being moved, verify that if the system needs to be requalified or not.
Excellent. Okay, well I see that we are getting the hook here. So there's a few others that will respond that are requesting some documentation, that we have plenty of documentation. Our website is full of resources. And again, you have a talented team that wakes up every morning looking to see how we can help you, our customers and our partners. So thank you very much. And I'll conclude the call at that point with a great thank you. So the call is over. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.